sky. All right, praise the Lord. Heaven's Jubilee. Now, let's don't fall asleep tonight now. Come on. Amen. Heaven's Jubilee. Praise God. One day to be worth it. Praise the Lord. Hang in there. Let's find another one here. All right, let's do one here. All right, let's do another one here. And just a little talk with Jesus. We see our offering tonight. And just give it to the Lord. Heavenly Father, bless the offering, bless the giver, bless the service. Once again, Lord, just have your way tonight, God. We thank you, we praise you, Father God, that just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in, and then the knock of heaven filled my soul. Well, he made my heart in love, and he wrote my name above. And just a little talk with Jesus, baby. Let us tell him about, oh, him, hear our fans cry, and he will answer by and by. Now when you into the ground of turning, know a little fire is burning, you will find the top of the mess around. Sometimes life is drear, without a ray of cheer, and then it comes down behind the light of day. And hide the starry skies, but just a little talk with Jesus, there's a way. Now let us, oh, let us get a light. Oh, he will hear and he will testify. Now when you feel the earth and you know the fire, why you will find a little talk with Jesus, there's a way. Here's what I do. Well, I go to him in prayer. Why, he knows my every care. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us give a lot. Oh, he'll hear our faith cry. And he'll answer by and by. Now when the prayer will turn, and you know a little fire burn, you will find a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Alrighty, praise the Lord. Amen. Just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Amen. Praise the Lord. We go to the Lord in prayer. I know James Mounts, we're going to have a special prayer for him. Had a really rough weekend, and he said he wasn't sure if he was going to be amongst the land of the living. That's how rough it was over the weekend for Brother James. And so we're going to have a special prayer for him. And so, any prayer requests? Carolyn. All right.
And just
we sure will. Someone else with a prayer request. Jim, sir. All right. Pray that is successful. Amen. Someone else with a prayer request. Vicki Worley. All right. Remember her sister-in-law, Brother Lewis, sir. Lewis family, we sure will. Anyone else with a prayer request?
We've got a good friend that's just had a cancer daughter.
All right, Michelle's friend, we sure will. Has cancer throughout her body. Let's pray God will intervene in that. Anyone else with a prayer request? Of course, remembering the service. Amen tonight. Amen. God will bless the group, and it's really happy to have you. So, anyone else tonight with a prayer request? Pray for Ruth, Deanne's co-worker. Alrighty then, all the will, come and join us around the altar. Come and join us. You see a lot of equipment, that's okay, there's plenty of room. Plenty of room for you, friend. Come and join us. Nothing like kneeling before an almighty God and going to the Lord in prayer. Amen.
Heavenly Father, once again, Lord, we just thank you, Lord, that once again we've had the privilege to gather in your house. And God, what a great place this to be, Lord. Like I've always said, to be with the brethren, God, to come together one mind and one accord. God, to see you move, God, and do something great again. You're an awesome God. Lord, we just got out of revival. We thank you, Lord, for that. It was an awesome second week, God. God, may the revival fires, God, stay burning within your people. Too often the fires go out too quick. But Lord, I refuse that the fire go out. God, I'm not ashamed of what I have, not afraid, and not intimidated, God. I know I serve an awesome God. And God, I want to keep the revival fire burning in me. Lord, bless the church, bless this service, Lord, these special requests. God, intervene, Lord, and just touch, Lord, each one that's sick. Touch those, Father God, that are afflicted. God, those got in the hospital. God, be with Brother Tom. Lord, he's home tonight, God, but he's still needing some special care. Lord, you heard Lewis' family, God, Vicky's request. Father God, Jim Moore's request. Carolyn's friend, Judy, God, and others. He just goes on and on, but God, nothing's too big for you. God, you're an awesome God, Lord, and I know, God, you still answer prayer. God, you still change hearts. God, you still meet needs. And God, I still know, Lord, you heal the sick. Lord, pass by this way tonight, God, and bless this service. Lord, bless Christian's ministry, God, as they come and sing for us, God, and minister, Lord. Your Son and Father, God, to obey you, God. Lord, when we obey you, God, we can never go wrong. Lord, just have you. We thank you, Lord, for this privilege, this honor. Once again, lift up holy hands and give you the praise you deserve. So, Lord, I thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your power. Thank you, God, for the Holy Ghost place a service, our power in this place tonight, God. God, I thank you and praise you for it in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Praise the Lord. Brother James, let's have a special prayer for him. We love Brother James. And he needs a touch in body. Amen. Need a touch in body. Amen. Heavenly Father, we call upon you because, Lord, we know you're able tonight to touch and to heal. Lord, once again, Father God, let us remind you of your word that says if two or three, Father God, would agree upon anything, God, it shall be done. So, Heavenly Father, I pray, God, Lord, you touch my brother from the top of the head, God, of the soles of his feet, Lord. God, touch him, God. I come against this bloodhead. God, I come against whatever went on in this stomach. I rebuke it. I bind it in the name of Jesus. Lord, touch and Lord, heal right now, God. Lord, you receive the honor and the praise and the glory for it. You are still the healer. You are still the one God who can do, Lord. We pray so that you stretch forth our hands and receive our healing. And I thank you, Lord. I believe, God, the touch is coming. It's done. Father God, right now in Jesus' name, praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Love you, buddy. All right. Anyone else maybe needing special prayer? Anyone else maybe needing special prayer at all? All right, this time, then we'll turn it over to Crusader Ministries. How many is glad to see them again here? Praise the Lord. Good to see Kendra. Amen. Praise God. And let's just have a good service. Do you mind the Lord tonight?
Well, amen. It's good to be back. And we've been getting to hang out up here in the Somerset area for about the last 2.5 weeks. And so I'm in awe of my Lord. Amen. You know, so many things happen throughout the days and throughout the times. And I just want you to understand something. You're not here by chance tonight. Maybe you're in need of something. There's been prayer already offered. But do you know that God's able? I believe he's able. I believe he's able tonight. Tempted and tried, we oft made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. Why? living about us, never molesting, though in the wrong.
Here.
call today. Get in the glory land way. Wanderers, come home, oh, hasten to obey. Get in the glory land way. And
I'm in the glory land way.
I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is near and the way groweth clear. I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is near and the way groweth clear. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Well, I'm in the glory land, weary land way. I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is near and the way groweth clear. I'm in the glory land way. Heaven is near and the way groweth clear. I'm in the glory. Amen. I pray you in the glory land way tonight. Amen.
Well, three Hebrew boys were thrown into the fire because they told the king they would not bow. But they said, listen, king, and you will know we serve a living God. We're not alone. Well, just as he's worked back then, he's working now. My God will never change. He has great power. And I know my God can do it. To him there's nothing to it. I know he'll see me through a sweet victory. And when the storms are raging, he is the rock of ages. I know that he is able, mighty is he. Well, I know.
Aren't you glad he's able? Come on, let's just give Jesus a hand clap of praise tonight. Well, amen. It is good to be back here and get to see all of y'all again. The last time that we was here, we was getting ready to do the same thing. Hit the road again. And a lot of you know, Kendra has seen a lot of miles since we left out that night from here. And I don't know how many thousands it's been, but it's been a bunch. And but it is just good to be with you. Penny said to tell you that she wanted to be in, but she's sitting out in the bus still trying to recover from getting sick. And so she's doing better. And so she's a praying, and she's sending out notice on Facebook that church is going on. Amen. Amen. And so it is just good to be with you. Have you enjoyed Mr. Stephen over there singing that lead part over there? Yeah, I think he's got music playing in his ears or something other. I don't understand all that over there, but he's all wired up. But he's doing a good job, and I'm thankful. We had a good time today. We went over and sang at Miss Michelle's place this morning where she works at. We pulled up in the parking lot across the street because that was the only place to park. And about the time we're getting stuff, getting ready, all of a sudden there's a lady looking up in the side of the bus. And So Stephen, he's sitting there on the front of the, and I said, well, say something to her. And he looks at me, goes, me?
I said, yeah, that'd be you. You say something to her. And she says, what are y'all doing here? And Stephen does this. And I said, so anyway, he tells her that we're singing across the road. And so she says, how come you're not singing for us? And so I stuck my head down. I said, hadn't nobody asked us? She said, you have been now. So we got done over there and came across the street and sang at, what's the name of that?
Highlands.
We were at Highlands. And so God blessed us. We had two great services this morning. And we're excited about tonight. Did you come expecting tonight? Amen. I did. I'm excited about that. And Kendra's going to share a lot with you tonight. I don't know what she's going to do. I love that look. I like to do that. But she's done. God is just... she's had an opportunity a lots of places across the country to share and to see what God is doing. But I'm going to tell you, I want her to sing you this song. It's one that she brought to us when she came, and it's become a staple in our ministry. To hold on, I held on. The Bible says He'll never leave you nor forsake you. He'll hold on to you. Amen. Listen to Kendra as she sings.
Claim to be a hero, and I don't have all the I held on. I held on.
I'd rather have Jesus. How about you?
Why don't you give Jesus a big hand clap of praise? Amen. I wanted to share just a few little testimonies. Some of the excitement that we've seen since we left here. I know a lot of you watch Facebook and you've kept up with us. But I'll never forget the night that we left and we began to make our way towards Florida from here. As we was on the bus, and it was about 1 o'clock in the morning, and Kendra said, "How close are we to Florida? I'm going to stay up till we get to Florida." And I said, "Well, we're not far." And as we made our way, she was sitting on the stepwell, Stephen was sitting in the seat, and I think Penny was asleep on the couch. And so we're driving, I said, "Kendra, we're crossing into Florida." And she said, "Oh, good. Good night." And she went to bed. But it was just wonderful, just as it's a joy to see the excitement of what God does. And these things that we get to see and experience. See, when the disciples would go out and they would come back in to tell Jesus what they had saw, there was a point of excitement about what had happened. Because it's not about David, it's not about Kendra, it's not about Stephen or Penny. It's about Jesus and what he does. And so we need to be excited about the things that happen and the things that go on and the different things that happened. And I shared with them the other night about Nelson. Nelson was on the last cruise that we was on. He was a maitre d' there. He's 43 years old, a Filipino man, has worked on the cruise line probably for 17, 18 years. Nelson didn't have a clue what John 3:16 is. So we begin to witness to him. And a friend of ours by the name of Keith Behaben, he's one of Jimmy Swaggart's associate pastors, was on the cruise with us, a good friend of ours. And as we're on there, all of a sudden things begin to happen and God begins to open doors. Do you know that God will open doors to allow you to minister? I don't care if you're on a cruise ship. I don't care if you're in Walmart. I don't care where you're at. And one of the things that we asked God to do the day that we boarded the cruise ship in Miami, Florida, we prayed in our prayer time that morning. We said, "God, give us opportunities to minister on this ship." And oh boy, did he give us opportunities. And Nelson was a 43-year-old Filipino man. And as he wrote down John 3:16, and Keith began to get him to write down that verse that we all have grown up on. And so he wrote it down. It didn't get completely through with it. And his phone went off and he had to go back to work. He said, "I'll be back." So and several hours passed by. And he had that sheet of paper out and Keith finished it out. And Keith told him, said, "Now I want you to read this tonight and learn it." He said, "What time do you have a break?" And he said, "I have a break at 10:30 tomorrow night." So at 10:30, out on the top deck of the ship, this ship was amazingly big. It was the third largest ship in the world. It was the Epic Norwegian. And it holds 5,000 passengers, 1,750 crew. That's 6,750 people, and it was full. And this thing is over 1,100 feet long. It's amazing how big it is. And so we're on there, and all of a sudden, God places out of 6,750 people an opportunity. So the next night at 10:30, Brother Keith, he begins to talk to Nelson. And he said, "Nelson, do you understand John 3:16? And he began to ask some questions. And before they walked away, Nelson had prayed and asked the Lord Jesus Christ into his heart to be his Lord and Savior. One verse of scripture. The Bible says that the word of God will accomplish what it sets out to do. Now here's the joy. Nelson was so excited about John 3:16. The next day he saw us and he flagged us down and he said, "I've asked many people that are sitting at my table." So I see them praying and I say, "Are you Christian?" And if they say yes, I say, "Do you know John 3:16? And he said, "I would like to say it for you." So he's going around the ship saying John 3:16. What happened to us that have been born in church and raised in church all of our life? We won't even say it on the steps of the church outside. He's going around on a cruise ship where people have paid thousands of dollars, and he's saying, do you know John 3:16? I love it. I love what the Word of God does. And there was just so many experiences. I remember one day we docked in Cozumel. And so it was me and Kendra and Stephen and Penny and Keith Babin. We're setting up on the top deck. We didn't even get off the ship. We stayed there studying the Word of God for hours on the top deck of the ship, going from one passage to the next passage, talking about our Lord, talking about our Savior. Do you know you can get really engrossed in the Word of God? Do you know it's the greatest book you'll ever read? And when you begin to start studying the Word of God, it's just amazing to see what happens. And time would just pass by. You know, the only thing you would do is you would get up and go get a plate of food and bring it back. And sit down and go back to eating and studying the Word of God. And then we moved from that table. Then it got a little hot out there, so we moved inside the air conditioning part. And we stayed there. And finally, it was about 11 o'clock that night that we finally all disbanded and went back to our room. Some wonderful things that we got to see. And I know that Kendra has shared with some of you maybe some of the things. And you be praying. God is opening a lot of doors that we're going to get to go. We're going to Israel coming up in October. And we're going to get to go sing and preach. I'm blown away that we're going to get to sing and preach in Israel. And I've been wanting to go for years. God's making a way. Aren't you glad that He's our provider? Amen. Amen. And coming up in August, we'll be making our way, well, in July, to the West Coast again. We'll be going back to California. And we're going into an Indian reservation. And we're going in and we're going to get to do a revival in the Indian reservation. And so we're excited about that. Stephen's not really excited. They don't have electricity there. And you know, the rest of us are saying, yes, that's good. That's good. You know, we're get out of our comfort zone. Kendra says, I like to be out of my comfort zone. And I'm thinking, I'm pretty older than you are, and I don't know if I want to be out of my comfort zone. But it's just amazing to see what God's doing. And I'm thrilled about everything that God is doing. And, you know, tonight we can talk about testimonies after testimonies after testimonies of the Lord. But I'm so thankful that He is in the saving business. I'm glad that He forgives. And my friend, nobody's been there like Jesus. You can say, well, Jesus really doesn't know what I've went through. No, you don't know what He went through. The Bible says that He sticks closer than a brother. I begin to think about this. He's a true friend. He called Judas Iscariot friend. How many of us, knowing that if someone was fishing to betray us, would say, friend? That's a friend. Listen to this song that a good friend of ours wrote. It's entitled, No One Has Been There Like You. Over the mountain.
took control, and he has been with me all along, and no one has been there like you. I travel down life's darkest road, burying my burdens, thinking I was alone, but just over the mountain.
Traveling on, I feel like traveling.
Yes, I feel like traveling on. Yes, my heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. Are you happy to be here tonight? Amen. Amen. You want to do it?
This song talks about making the Lord your anchor. Most through our lives, we try to do stuff on our own, and it's really silly. It's really silly, and every time we think we give everything to God, we took it all back. I mean, that's what we do. And everything is chaos and destruction, and it's turmoil, and nothing's working out right, and you keep messing up. So this song, I wrote it last year, and it talks about making the Lord your anchor. It seems every step I take, I trip on another mistake. Sometimes it becomes a fight, my flesh and heart against my soul. Oh, my faith begins to slip. Oh, but can I remember this? No matter what, you will never let me go. Take my hand and lead me home. Guide my steps into this battle.
Steps until this battle is done. Oh Lord, I can't do this on my own.
people, the priests who sing your praise. I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, but it's only found in one place. Take me into the holy of holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me into the holy of holies. My lips, here I am. Take me past the outer courts and to the holy place. Oh, past the brazen altar, Lord, I want to see your face. Take me by of people, the priests who sing your praise. I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, but it's only found in one place. Take me into the holy of holies. Take me in by the blood of the
Praise the Lord. I'm telling you, God is so good. Amen. Amen. He is so good. Hey, Stephen, would you run out and get my wife on my bed? I wanted to share just a couple of things. You can stay with me. You know, Kendra has been such a blessing to us. And I shared with her mom when we got back up this way, just... I know y'all know how special she is, and what a wonderful young lady of the Lord that she is. But I wanted to share some testimony for just a moment, and you know, here's the thing: I'm not bragging on Kendra; I'm bragging on the Father. Amen. A church in Oklahoma. There's so many of them that when we leave there, they say, "This is my daughter or granddaughter now." They come up and they hug her. They said, they'll pull me to the side and they'll say, "She is such a blessing." And I said, "Yeah, I know." I said, "I'm thrilled that God has brought her into our midst, you know, for whatever time period that is." But it's from one church to the next church. And so here's the thing. Some of you here have sown some seed. Some of you have planted seed, and there's a harvest that's being given. A lot of times we don't get the opportunity to see the harvest. We hear of things, but I wanted to share this with you so you'll know the long nights, the days that we're out there doing what we do, that she is representing this church well. She's standing firm on the word of God. She's not swaying. Now listen to me. This is a young lady that's more concerned about modesty than I've ever seen in my life. She's very concerned about dressing appropriately. There's yet to be a time that she'll come out and she'll say, "Miss Penny or Brother David, is this okay to wear?"
Oh, our morals today have gone to the tubes. They've gone away. But she's concerned about representing her Lord. I get amazed as I watch, just like when we'll be on the cruise ship. Now here's the thing. Just like the cruise that we just went on back a month and a half ago, all four of us are in a room together. We live on a bus together. You have to stay above reproach, my friend. You can play games with God, but he don't play games. I'm going to stand before him one day and he's going to say, why did you do that? You knew that that wasn't right. What would folks think? And so when Penny and I had won the cruise through First Fitness that we do, there were so many of them that said, well, you and Penny are just going to come by yourself. And I said, no. My children, and these two are not my blood kin, but they're my brother and my sister. And God has placed them into our care. And so I told them, well, yeah, they're coming. Well, they didn't win it. I said, it don't matter. Do you know what it's like to wake up and see this one walk to the door of the patio or the balcony and open it in Jamaica and say, wow, this is beautiful. Look what God did. Do you know this one right here, when he walks to the edge of the railing and he says, is that pirates? You have. Not this time, he said. But that's the joy of serving the Lord. So I want you to know that you've planted good seed and they're coming to harvest. They're bringing in a good crop. Amen. It's about bringing in a crop. You need to be sowing good seeds in your own life. What kind of seed are you throwing out there? What do the people see in Somerset and Ferguson, Burnside, Monticello? When you walk in, what do they see? It's about the seed that we plant. Do they see you as just being a Sunday morning Christian? Hello? Do they see? I know this is Wednesday night, so you're here. I understand that. What do they see? When you talk, do you represent Jesus Christ? What do you represent? Well, that, you can't believe what that man did to me. And when I went down there to that car lot, and he just stiffed me when I come out of there and everything else. Well, you had a choice to walk in and walk out without anything. He didn't force you. But you could have sown a seed right there. You could have said, hey, brother, looks like you're having a bad day. Can I pray for you right now? No, what seed are we throwing? There's been some good seed thrown. Been some good seed sown. So I want you to be encouraged. I want you to be encouraged, and I want you to pray for her. Because it ain't all glamour riding in that bus. How many of you laid awake at night? Been thousands of miles away from home, just yearning to go hang out with your friends. Life's real. Life is real. I'm telling you some real things tonight. I'm telling you that there's a lot of you that need to get real in your life. You need to quit playing church. It's time that we get real and serve God the way that He did. We have some heart-to-heart talks. You know, in 45 feet, you can have some heart-to-heart talks. You can't run far. And we sit down and we pray and we love on one another. We study the Word of God. And we study the Word of God. And we study the Word of God. And we study the Word of God. Because without it, I have found over these last 27 years, if you don't study the Word of God, you'll fold up like a cheap suitcase. Without Him, you can't do nothing. So I'm telling you, pray. Satan doesn't like what we do, and it's already, there was a lot of prophecy that was given in this church towards her. There's been a lot of prophecy that's been giving outside this church that doesn't even know any of y'all that witnessed to what was said here, that what's going to happen with her and what God's going to do. It's been prophesied that she'll travel worldwide. Are we going to Israel? We're going to Costa Rica. She's already been to Mexico 3 times. She's been to Jamaica and she's been to Grand Cayman. God's doing a work. And I'm sharing this with you because I'm bragging on my father because of some things that have been sown. We need to sow into these young people right back here. We need to sow into them. You that are older have wisdom. You don't need to be closing your mouth. You need to be opening it and saying, listen, I want to tell you something, because you're headed down the wrong road. If you head down that road right there, there's trouble at the end of it. We don't even tell them about detour signs anymore. Oh, I don't want to offend them. They might not come back. Wear their tail out with a belt. That's what needs to happen. And tell them, I know what I'm talking about. I know, and I'm going to tell you because it's going to save you some headache in the long run. It's time that we do what the Word of God says. We're running out of time, people. We are in the last days of the last minutes, possibly the last seconds before our Lord could come. Now, I'm excited about that. I don't know about the rest of y'all, but I'm excited about that. There's an anxiousness that is inside of me. And, you know, and I'm thinking about this, and I'm thinking about, Lord, if he tarries before we get to go to Israel, I said, wouldn't it be cool if we were standing there when he came back? My, my, my. Talk about get your heart pumping. Get you excited about what God's doing in your life. My friend, you can get as excited right here in Somerset as what we can going to Israel. Because there's a Samaria that's all out here. Nobody wants to go no more. Jesus said, I must go through Samaria. You find that in John chapter 4, by the way. There's some of you that need to go into Samaria because you got some family that's hanging out in there. And you need to go in there and you need to testify to them of what Jesus can do in their life. Oh, well, I've done that for years and they don't pay me no attention. Old Buck over there, he's going to drink, he's going to smoke and all this kind of stuff. Well, what about one more time? What if it's the one more time? What if it's one more time? I wanted to share these things with you because God really impressed on me. Time is drawing nigh. And we need to be busy. We don't have time to sit around no more. We done sat around too long and look at what shape our government's in. We done sat around and said, nah, my vote don't matter. We've been quiet in the church. We've let sin walk in the door and take over in churches. I can tell you, we was in 270 churches last year. And I don't know how many. We've only been back to Magnolia 14 nights this year. But I can tell you one thing. There's a pattern across the United States of America, and it ain't coming closer to God. It's falling away. It's falling away from God. God's looking for a few that are willing. And I'm thankful for the hard decisions that have been made. And she's willing to get back on that old bus and say, God, I'm going to serve you. I'm going to do what you call me to do. Now, if you quit praying for her, she'll know it. She'll feel it in her spirit. God's done equipped her with that. She's got that inside of her, and she knows, and she feels those prayers the same way we do. So I'm encouraging you tonight to pray. Pray like you've never prayed before, because Satan ain't playing. I'll say that one more time. Satan ain't playing. He's done notified the divisions that are over in California. That bunch is coming. They're coming to that Indian reservation, and you better be getting your troops prepared. Don't think he ain't playing. He's for real. Oh, he's real right here too. He's real. So in your walk and in your life, God has asked me this several times, and I've shared this. I shared this the other night. It's amazing how God will ask you certain things at certain times and certain places. He'll remind you of things, Pastor. I was working on the bus. It was back the first part of May. We'd come by home. It was running hot, and I decided to change the water pump on it, hoping that that would cause the temperature to go down on it so where we could continue to travel. So I pulled it off one day, and the water pump on this thing weighs about 25 pounds. It's a big old pump. And it's not in an easy place to get to. You have to get under the bus. So I took it off one day. The next morning I got up at 5, headed 110 miles to pick up the other one to get back. When I got back home, it wasn't sunshiny. It was more of a liquid form of sunshine running across the ground. Well, I had a 1x12 that I laid on top of to keep from laying into the water. So I'm buckling up hoses up underneath there, and it's raining so hard that it's flooding over the board. And I'm soaked from front to back. And so as I'm laying there, grease from one end to the other, working on that clamp, it's like somebody came and laid down on this side right next to me. And you ever had that feeling when one of your kids all of a sudden would come and they'd be looking at the same thing that you're looking at? And you'd look over there, and it's like the Lord just said all of a sudden, hey, what's the price of a soul worth to you? What's the price of a soul worth to you? See, because as I'm up under that bus wringing wet, soaking wet from one end to the other, Satan had done told me, just call them and tell them you're going to be late. I just keep working. God reminded me when he said that, he said, it's really easy for you to stand up on that platform behind that piano and tell people what a soul's worth to them. But what about right now while you're ringing wet under this bus? What is it worth to you? I said, yes, sir. I get it. Brother Jeff, I tighten that clamp on up. And I put water in that old bus. And we left out. And it carried us about another 700 miles. Then the next stop was the engine place where we dropped it off. That God made a way. So I'm going to ask you tonight, at 8:22, what's the price of a soul worth to you? We think a lot of times when we give a love offering that it ought to be worth a dollar bill. I believe over in the book of Corinthians, it says, if you sow a little, you'll reap a little. If you sow a lot, you'll reap a lot. That's God's math. I know I'm understanding God's math on how he can take a church with 12 people in it and use a couple out of that church to spend $21,000 on an engine. $21,000. And then the pastor says, well, we won't send them crusaders out of here with the most offering that they've ever seen from this little old bitty church. And he talks just like this. And I love him to death. He said, you folks, you need to give while it hurts. He said, we got a building program going on here, but said, if you got money stored back to go in that, you put it in here because they sowing seed out there presenting the gospel. You ain't going to go, and they will. And I'm kind of like just big-eyed thinking, okay, pastor, you know. And I'm sharing this because remember, I told you, I'm not talking about us. I'm bragging on the Lord. I'm bragging on what he can do. And I don't know why I feel so compelled to share this with you, because I usually don't even talk about stuff like this. But I want you to know something. If you'll use 12 folks to bless in that kind of way with the motor, and then they gave us a $5,000 offering. That's God. Because that's what gets us on down the road to be able to go. And that's how I know that God is called and God continues to call. And that's how I know that these young folks that are standing right up here are going to go further than I could ever imagine. Do you know the impact that they're going to have when they get back from Israel? If God tarries and they've walked over there and they said, I've been in the tomb and it's empty. I've been out on the Sea of Galilee. I was baptized in the River Jordan. I put my hand on the Via Dolorosa where my Lord walked up. Do you understand even what that's about? See, I don't even have it. I try to figure it out. But all I know is I'm going to serve him. I'm going to serve him and do all that I can. I've shared my heart with you about the things that are coming up, and I'll ask you to be obedient. I didn't ask Pastor. If I'm out of order, he can straighten me out. I promise you that. I don't have a problem with that. But I feel like that you want to sow into Kendra's ministry, and she is a part of this ministry, and this provides. Let me just tell you, do you know what it's like to take a $100 offering and split it five ways? It's tough. It's tough. I don't know of many folks that'll live off $100 split five ways, 20 bucks a week, that'll stay up the hours. That'll stay up the hours. Sleep in a bunk about this wide. Then get up in the morning and work. See, we don't just ride down the road. When they get up and start their morning, start their day, we're working. They're booking. This young lady has a gift that is out of this world. She can get on that phone, and it is so amazing to hear her talk to people that she's never seen before. God has blessed her and blessed her and blessed her. She has great organization skills, by the way. You can look at her bunk above hers where she keeps all of her stuff. It's all organized. If it gets out of place, if we go over a bump, some of it slings off. Here she goes back there. She starts all over, takes it all down, puts it back up there. She said, I'm getting organized. Stephen and I, we just have a spot where we throw stuff, and her and Penny's got everything organized. We go in there, and I say, where's the coffee at? Oh, we moved it over here because it's more convenient. Okay, but I ask you, would you sow into the ministry and the souls that we're going after? We've seen 114 this year come to know the Lord. So, is it okay now if we receive an offering right now? Okay. Can I be so bold to do something?
Yes.
All right. I'm going to put this right here. Here's what I want to do. I'm not looking. I'm not looking to see who's putting anything in here. But if you want to give to this ministry, I'm going to ask you to get out of your comfort zone. To give. I'm not going to pass it around. I'm going to ask you to come up and place it in. I'm not looking to see what you're giving because it's none of my business. If you can't, well, that's okay. You can pray. So you be obedient. I'm going to ask Kendra, would you sing that song, Let It Rain? Father, I thank you for what you're fixing to do. God, I thank you for what you have placed into people's heart. And Lord, you know my heart. It's not about me. It's not that I'm out to do anything but just serve you. Lord, I know I will stand before you and give an account of every jot and tittle that I have ever spoke. And so, Lord, I ask you right now, Lord, that people would give just out of the love that they have for you to sow, that we'll be able to continue, and we're going to continue to do what you've called us to do. And Father, I pray for those that, God, they just say, I don't have anything to give, but Father, they have themselves that they can give to you in through prayer and studying and spending time praying. So Father, I thank you now for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. So I ask you to come.
Amen. I've been excited about, we've carried the cajon around for so long, and this seems to be, since we came back to Somerset, it's just jumped right back out in on the platform again, and I love it, and I just love to see the looks when Kendra sets down and begins to play it, and we've looked at a lot of different options on playing it, as I said, she wants to be sure that she's representing her Lord, and she has learned to play it sideways. It just blows my mind, and so she does wonderful at it. Amen. And
open the eyes of my heart.
want to see you.
Yeah.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
I want to see you. Yeah.
I want to see you. I want to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out. We sing holy, 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 holy. Yes, you are holy,
holy, holy.
Thank you, are
holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Yeah.
Sing with us.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart.
I want to see.
I want to see you,
yeah.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord, and
open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
To see you high and lifted up,
shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power.
We sing
holy, 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 holy.
Yes, you are
holy, holy, holy,
Lord, you are
holy, 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 holy. I want to see you.
I asked Stephen at the beginning of the service, today he shared a couple of times during the services, and it was very, I don't know, the passage just spoke to me, and I asked him, I said, I would like for you to share what you did with the church tonight. It was a strong word, and so you go ahead, son, you do, and you get everything going. You got it? Oh, there he goes. All right.
You know, this morning we went over, like he said, and sung at the nursing home and the retirement home here in Somerset. And I shared from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 19. And it says, "And to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above that all we may ask or think, according to the power that works in us." And it really dawned on me, it says to work in the fullness of the power of God. You have no fullness of God in your heart unless you have a relationship with Jesus. Amen. And you know, for many years, at the age of 9 years old, I walked down the aisle and I thought I got saved. And started running sound at the age of 10 and have been in church ever since, pretty much. But all that time, I would read my Bible, I would pray up until February the 22nd of 2013 when I actually got saved. But up until February the 22nd, I would read my Bible,
The truth.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. What a joy it has been to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Amen. Amen. I kind of caught a glimpse of the clock a while ago, and I said, "Wow, it doesn't get dark up here early. It gets dark late." And I looked up there, and I'm seeing it's 9:10 already, and time has flown by. Do you know that time is flying faster by the moment, because it's getting closer to the Lord's return? Amen. But thank you for allowing us to worship with you tonight, to brag on the name of Jesus. Everything that's been said tonight is not about us. It's about Jesus Christ and what he's done and what he's doing. And I'm thankful for that. And I'm thankful for each one of you. I thank you for your prayers. And you continue to pray. And like I said, tonight we'll be making our way towards Petersburg, Kentucky. And we're going to make our way up there to the Creation Museum. And we're going to try to spend a couple of days studying, trying to learn more about our world and how God created it, and to go out and to be able to tell others about Jesus. The Bible says to study to show thyself approved. And so, because in this day and time, you can't go out half ready. Amen. And we need to be fully ready. I have an exciting announcement that I want to make for you. We're in the process of finishing. We're going to finish up a recording and be featuring Kendra on there, and Stephen, and a lot of stuff that we've sung tonight will be on there. And so we're taking pre-orders. If you would like to be a part of that, what we're doing is for $20. You can go ahead and pay for the CD tonight. We will mail you the CD as soon as we get them off, burned off and ready to go. And we're hoping to have that by the end of June, and you'd have them back up here. So if you want to do that, we're going to be back there in the back. I'd be glad to help you along with that as well. And so thank you for what you've done. Thank you for what you're going to do. So I'm going to ask you all, by the show of hand, would y'all pray for us as we go? Yeah. Yeah. Amen. I thank you for that. And now then, I'm going to ask you this question. Are you praying for your church? Yeah. You need to be praying for your church. And you continue to do that. And so I thank you. So, Pastor?
I'd like to hear about Kendra to say a few words. How's it been on the
Yeah. I know she spoke at the ladies' conference, didn't she? Different things. I'd like to hear some things going on.
Yeah.
How do you like to hear that?
Yeah. I'm glad you said that. I looked at her four or five times. Yeah, I looked at her. I like, say something. Say something.
Oh, my goodness. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I don't know what to talk about.
Tell us what happened at your ladies' conference. What happened?
I talked about the Lord. Okay, but I'd always said before I ever started traveling, I always told my friends, I was like, you know I'm going to be traveling, right? I never knew it was going to happen, but I knew it was. I didn't know when. And I would always tell them, I remember there was this girl at work, like 2 months before I left to go out on the road, and I said, we were talking about traveling, and I said, hey, you know I'm going to be traveling. I promise you that. I will be. And she was like, you're so confident in it. I was like, I will be. I know I'm going to be singing for the rest of my life for my Lord. And then 2 months later, I'm actually traveling. And I bet that was just amazing for her to be like, what? Yeah. But it's been hard, of course, and Satan's attacked. And getting on a bus, I'm sorry, you guys, but getting on a bus with people you don't really know, that is very difficult. I always wanted to leave my mama. I was like, I can do it. And then I leave her, and then I'm like, I need you. As soon as I left her, I was like, no, I didn't know how much. You know, you need your parents, people. You don't realize how much you need them till they're gone or you're gone. And, oh, it was, yes, and it's been quite something. I have, maybe through singing, but I haven't prayed with anybody to the Lord yet. I've been praying for that opportunity, and I've walked up to random people and ministered to them, but it's pretty cool. Oh, dear. Yes. Oh, Mexico. And I'm going to Costa Rica and Israel. I don't know where Costa Rica's at, but I guess that's another country. It would have to be, right? It's somewhere out there. I don't know, 12, 13, 14. 14 different states, so it's been amazing. But the churches today, this is something I have noticed, and I will tell you guys, it's very, let's get real here. We go in a lot of churches, and I don't even know how it's even possible for the church to even make it. We've been in I don't know how many churches, and nobody cares about the youth. They wouldn't care about Derek or Brian. They wouldn't care. And you go to these churches, and they don't even try to bring them in, but Derek and Brian, they're the generation. We are. We're the next church. Once you guys are gone, who do we have? And nobody even seems to care. Nobody seems to care about the Lord. So that's what I have noticed. So I've grown a lot and in the Lord. And oh, I'm probably almost 10. I would say kind of, sort of. Some of them I like write a verse and a chorus and then I can't get the rest. I get stuck. But I would definitely be praying for churches out there because nobody's serious about God. They're part-time Christians is what I call them. Jesus is a part-time job. That's what he is. He's a go to church on Sunday and Wednesday and the rest of the week drink and cuss and do all that stuff. So we need to be praying. And who in this church is going to take a stand? I don't know. If I had to do a 5 out of 10, 3 out of 10, I don't, maybe would take a stand. But it's crazy to see so many different things and so many denominations and churches, but they're all still the same. They're all still dying on the inside, and they're crying out, and some of them are sitting in church and searching for answers. It's right there, and they won't even come to the altar to get it. But just keep us in your prayers, definitely, because so far it's been rough but awesome. You know, with Satan attacking, because he's attacked the bus I don't know how many times. But it's definitely going to get more difficult. It's definitely going to get a lot more difficult. So just keep us in your prayers, because God's got big plans. That's what I have to say.
The song that she's talking about is a song that's entitled, I Will Trust in You. There was a man from East Texas by the name of Terry Caffey. Terry was a youth pastor at a church. Family raised and married. Daughter was the oldest. Two sons. Very active in their church that they were in. Everything seemed to be normal. You know how we gauge things, normal. One day his daughter met a young man that came to church. The young man was about 5 years older than his daughter. And over a period of a short time, he began to notice a change in his daughter's attitude. She began to get rebellious. She began to sneak out of the house and party with this young man. So the dad, he told her, said, look, I don't want you seeing him no more. He can come to church, but he's not to be around you. This infuriated his daughter. She was so mad because nobody was going to tell her who she could see. 16 years old. So she began to plot how she could be with this young man. And she began to figure out how she could kill her family. That's right, kill her family. So one night, a Wednesday night after church, they had been to church, youth time. Brother Terry said him and his wife were in their bed. Everything was normal. He woke up in the middle of the night to gunshots at the foot of his bed. His wife blown out of bed from the gunshots, and he jumps over on top of her to protect her. Is shot 11 times. And while he is right there, he realizes his wife is already dead. And he hears upstairs, he hears his oldest son say, "Charlie, don't do this. Charlie." And then there's silence. He said he guessed he passed out from the loss of blood and the shock that he was in. The next thing that he remembered was waking up and saying he needed to go check on his family to make sure that they were okay. And as he crawls to the bedroom door and reaches up and grabs the knob and opens the door up, smoke fills the house up into their room. They had set the house on fire. Now, Charlie was the young man's name that the girl was dating. Laying there, I can't even imagine what it would be like to even think about all of that. But he says, "I've got to get to somebody to tell him who has done this awful thing to his family." So he crawls out the bathroom window. Now, we all know that those bathroom windows are very small. He's shot 11 times, and he crawls through the bathroom window and crawls over 100 yards in the middle of the night to the neighbor's house. He said all that he could remember was after he got outside and began to crawl away, and he began to, you know, the flames were behind him. He could see this little light because his neighbors always kept the light on over the stove. And he said, "I could see it through the side door of the house." And he said, "That's what kept me going, was that light." He said the next thing that he remembered was waking up in the hospital. Nurse there and a doctor was talking, and the nurse said, "It's something that his daughter's okay." The doctor responds and says, "But she's been charged with the murder of her family." Brother Terry said, "I did not want to live." 3 months passed by, many surgeries. Brother Terry was out of the hospital, living with his sister. Just couldn't understand. So he's going to end it all. Slides out a drawer and gets a pistol out. Sticks it in his pocket, drives to where his once beautiful two-story log home stood in East Texas. Walking around out there, going to take his life. Looking up to God and shaking his fist. And he said all of a sudden his attention is drawn to a piece of paper that's flapping out in the woods. The edge of the grass, and he walks over and picks up this piece of paper. And he recognizes it, that it's a page out of the book that his wife was reading the night that this happened. Now, 3 months has passed by. There's already grass growing up where his house once stood. And as he looks at this piece of paper, there's a line that is highlighted and underlined, and it says, "I don't understand why you took my family, but I will trust in you." And he said at that very moment, he fell to his knees and cried out to God. So I ask you this question tonight.
We all say, yes, Lord, I'll trust in you. But what about in those days? Those unbearable moments where we think that no one's, how could God even care for me? Why would he be putting me through this? Will you trust in him? See, his ways are not our ways. His understanding is so much ahead of ours. So we wrote this song, is entitled, I Will Trust in You. Sifting through the ashes of everything he had, only burned up pain and memories was he holding in his hand. He begins to cry, but the tears, they would not come. The pain so deep inside him, feeling lost and alone. With his fist in the sky and asking God, oh why, he bows his face and he begins to some things you cannot see, still I'll believe only in you. I will trust in you. With all that I am, I will trust in you. Sometimes in your life, the storms, they will rage. Dark clouds, they will gather with the lightning and the rain. In the midst of the darkness, a voice begins to cry. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I will trust in you, I will trust in you. Some things you cannot see, still I'll believe. Brother Terry wouldn't have his wife or his two sons to come back for nothing in this world.
because they knew Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And so they are worshiping at the feet of Jesus right now. Brother Terry's daughter is incarcerated in the Texas Department of Corrections, serving a life sentence. She is now born again. She knows the Lord as her personal Savior, shares her testimony about what happened on that dark night, and has led many to come to know the Lord Jesus while she's been in prison. You see, God restores. You find that in the book of Job. He is remarried, has two beautiful sons. In God something. Give God the praise tonight. Amen. Amen. You can go to our website, thecrusadersministries.com, and there's over 500 videos of services. You can watch the live services. We try to post that up, and so you can keep up with where we're at. And also, if you can't watch them, you can go back and go to the archive, and you can pull them up. And you can spend hours of watching services, eh? And you can learn all the Crusader songs, amen, and sing those. Also, at any point in time, there you can go to the website and you can actually continue to donate to the ministry. There's a donate button on there, and you can take care of that if God places it on your heart to give to one of the mission trips. As we go to the Indian reservation, the pastor that he's in San Francisco, and we're doing a revival out there before we go into the Indian reservation. He said, last year when we were there, he said, I wish that we could go to the reservation, that y'all would go up there and do some services. And I said, let's do it. He said, brother, it doesn't pay. I said, I didn't ask you that, did I? I said, let's do it. So when I called him at the beginning of this year and we began to pray and seek the dates as to what God would do, and he told me the other day, he said, I cannot believe that this is going to happen. And see, we're going to have to park the bus about 90 miles from there. We're going to have to rent a van to go in because we can't even get the bus to the Indian reservation because it's so far back into the mountains there in Northern California. And so we'll be going in there. And so anyway, any of the mission trips, you can go online. You can donate to those. We've got to, I guess, by tomorrow or the next day, we've got to put our deposit down, the rest of it on the Israel trip. And then we'll be working on the rest of the money that we have before we go on that as well. So do you believe God is faithful? I believe he'll supply all of our needs. Amen. I believe that with all of my heart. Well, has it been good to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. Amen. Well, we thank you. We thank you for allowing us to worship. And y'all got a lot out of Kendra tonight. I'm telling you, she talked more up here tonight I'm excited to see how God is opening and doing more and more in her life and in Stephen's life. Didn't Stephen?